We have the Quran, the Arabic from Allah, the word of Allah. No Muhammad's word inside, separate compartment. Then we have the Hadith, different compartment. Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, you know, Imam Ghazali, Ibn Taymiyyah, this and that. Separate books, separate books, separate books. But all the other religion, they have it all in one. We say, no, this could not be the word of God. It's the word of God, yes, but it contained the word of man. It contained history. It contained a lot of information that is not tantamount to be the word of God. So Mr. Brown was helpless within minutes. I said, okay, now that you agree with me that what you got is a translation, it is not the original. Because at the time of Jesus and Suleiman, there was no English language. How could there be English Bible? Now that we agree, watch the next step. I said, Mr. Brown, I want you to open the Songs of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 16. Open it in your Bible and I'm going to read it. If I make any mistake, take me up. He opened. I said, just look at it, but I'm going to read. It reads, his skin is like that of the Lebanese. His mouth is beautiful. He is altogether lovely. He is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. I said, Mr. Brown, did you see Muhammad there? He said, no. I said, well, because you translate everything in English. The same book, everything in Hausa Bible. So you can never see Muhammad. I said, Mr. Brown, what is my name? He said, Muhammad Awwal. I said, okay, fine. What is the meaning of Muhammad Awwal? Muhammad is the praised one. Awwal is the first. So my name is the praised one, the first, right? He said, yeah. I said, okay, today is Saturday. Let's say tomorrow, Sunday, someone came here and he said, oh, yesterday, the first one, the praised one, came here and gave a lecture. Would you know that I came and gave a lecture? For million years, you will never know that I came and gave a lecture because you translate my name, which you don't have the right to do. So you translate Muhammad's name. That's why you didn't see Muhammad. Now his logic is coming. He was quiet. He said, well, so what do you mean? And now I have to explain. I said, Mr. Brown, I'm going to read for you. Do you speak Hebrew? He said, no. I said, you see, I speak some Hebrew. It's good for me. Because I'm doing my dawah. I need to understand the Bible in Greek and Hebrew. So I understand a little bit of it. I said, let me read that same, you know, Songs of Solomon 5:16 in the language of Suleiman alayhi salam, the way he said it, as in your book English. It reads, Hiko hiko mamitatim fi kullu zahudin muhammadim vazamra'i bayna yahushalam. I say, Mr. Brown, did you see the Hebrew language of the same quotation? Hiko hiko mamitatim fi kullu zahudin muhammadim vazamra'i bayna yahushalam. Allah said, Allazi yajdu nahu maktuban indakum fit tawrat wal injil. He's in the book. Do you know what he said? He said, oh, wait, wait, wait. I said, what? He said, you say muhammadim. He didn't say Muhammad. Very ingenious. He said, he didn't say Muhammad. I heard you. It says Muhammadim. That's not Muhammad's name. Muhammad's name is Muhammad. Uh-huh. So how about that? I said, okay, let me explain. In the Hebrew language, im or am is a suffix of respect. Anytime they add im or am at the end of your name, that means with great respect. The name of God Almighty in the Hebrew language is El or Eleh or Allah or Eli or Elohim. If they say Elohim, like altogether great and powerful, Elohim, they don't mention those words because it's a greater word. So the name of Muhammad is Muhammad Im. Solomon gave him that Im or Am as a tradition or respect. Muhammad Im with all greatness. And Muhammad is the greatest. Wa innaka la ala khuluqul azim. Thou, O Muhammad, stand on the most exalted of all characters. Solomon, he knew that. So he didn't call him Muhammad out of respect. He said, Muhammadim. Mr. Brown said, you know what? I'm hungry. Let me eat my food, man. And he started eating. But that's the truth. When the truth comes, now it's up to you. You don't press it. So I left it at that. I'm not going to push it. Like Rafidin, you can't compel anyone by force, but I will leave that to him. He's going to go home, he's going to start thinking. You know, you don't have to accept Islam. You plant the seed. Maybe it will germinate sometime to come. Allah is the one that is the one who gave. The hidayah. Hidayah is from Allah. أَفَمَنْ شَرَخَ اللَّهُ صَدَرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ فَهُوَ عَلَىٰ نُورٍ مِنْ رَبِّهِ. If Allah wants you, He expands your breast, He infuses Islam in it. That is the grace of Allah. So He is ours is to present Islam. Allah is the one that gives hidayah. So I stop it at there. Then the verse continue. He shall not cry, nor would you find him lifting his voice in the street. He's talking to that person who is to come. He will never cry, and he will never lift his voice in the street crying. Muhammad never does that. You never see Muhammad crying. You never see him lifting. But they say it's for Jesus. Okay, when Jesus was on the cross, what did he say? They say he was on the cross. I don't believe that. If I'm doing, was Christ crucified or crucifixion? Then I will give you more details. Today is not the day. Maybe it will come some other time and I will do a topic separate from that. But this is talking about that man or that prophet, the chosen one, the Mustafa, the elected one, will never cry on the street. He will never lift his voice to be heard by anyone. Muhammad is always in seclusion, praying to Allah. He doesn't cry. But Jesus was crying all over the place. When he was arrested, they say, they beat him, they kick him, they spat on his face, and he was crying. You know? And he said, my Lord, you know, why hast thou forsaken me? He was crying in the street, carrying the cross. That's what they say. We don't believe in that, but that's what they say. So Muhammad never cried. There was not a single hadith or any narration that Muhammad was crying in public because of the pain that he sustained. Sometime he was doing salat, they would come and pour the entrail of an animal on him. He would never wake, he would just wake and sleep. His daughter Fatima, may Allah be pleased with her, she would come and clean his body, and she started crying. Muhammad never, he's always in communion. Oh Allah, forgive them their sin, because they never know the right. When he was in Taif, what happened? The angel came. You know what happened to Taif? They kick him out, they stone him, break his teeth. So he went and sat on a rock. And Zayd came and fortified him with his clothes. Stop that, he's the messenger of Allah. They laughed at him. He got a broken teeth, you know. So the angel came and said, Ya Rasulullah, Allah have sent me, see all these rocks? I could pull it down, all of them, finish, bury all the Taif. He said, la, no. Ya Allah, have mercy on them. If they don't worship you, their ancestors and children and children, they will come to worship you. Last year when I went to Hajj, I went to Taif. I couldn't believe my eye. Allahu Akbar. The prayer of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam went so deep. The Taif who were destroyed, not all the cities around him, accept Islam because of his fortified fortitude, always in communion. So this is what Allah is talking about. And the Bible continues by saying, I will keep thee, I will keep you as a covenant of all the nations, and you will become a light for the Gentiles. The Gentiles. Jesus didn't come for the Gentiles. He told the disciples, do not go into any way of the Gentiles. Don't go.